Hi friends, my name is host Eric and I'm going to make a video today in a series that I'm never going to do, but part of a series called History's Greatest Loadies. Now, History's Greatest Loadies celebrates those historical figures who attained greatness and were also huge loadies. A couple of examples, Winston Churchill comes to mind, the good Dr. Hunter S. Thompson, obviously, W.C. Fields, I mean, I don't know if he was a great artist or anything, but he was definitely a big drunk. Dorothy Parker fits into this category, and she's a little bit less well-known, perhaps, than those others, and one of the few women that would make the list of history's greatest loadies. I am extraordinarily fond of Dorothy Parker's style. She's badass. And I want to share with you a little bit of reasons why she's so badass. So let's start with her quotes. The one that prompted my video about creativity and Parker inversions, which is what I call this thing right here, is this quote from hers. I'd rather have a bottle in front of me than a frontal lobotomy. Okay, so as far as Parker inversions go, that's the platonic form of it. You can't come up with anything, and I've been spending a lot of time trying to come up with these. I've come up with several. I've come up with, like, I'd rather have beside a pen than appendicitis within. I'd rather have 10 tests on good humor than intestinal tumors. I've come up with, I'd rather be spawning in mud than vomiting blood. But no matter how hard I try, I will never come up with anything as good as, I'd rather have a bottle in front of me than a frontal lobotomy. That's just absolutely stunningly brilliant. And you know, her writing was so, so right across the board. You can lead a horde of culture, but you can't make her think. Fantastic. Absolutely fantastic. She was pleased to have him come and never sorry to see him go. This woman was very ahead of her time. Now, she came into being in the 20s during the flapper time, you know. Brevity is the soul of lingerie. Take me or leave me, or as is the usual order of things, both. She had a very unhappy life. And part of it is because she started in the 20s in this wild, free, hey, let's emerge into the 20th century, liberated from Victorian mores. And when artists come of age during these periods, they inevitably end up sucking ass at some point, or being deeply troubled like this lady. So look at Bob Dylan, and a lot of those 60s things, right? In like Summer of Love, that kind of stuff, Woodstock era. All of those people suck ass, mostly, because they were too much enamored of their moment, right? Which sacrificed their capacity to be timeless. Look at someone like Bob Dylan, who attained ultimate relevance with the time period in like 1967 or 68, and spent the rest of his life neurotically wrestling with the fact that he wasn't very talented and doesn't have any capacity to really live up to the status that they afforded him, right? And not a good artist at all, but burdened with these labels of genius and stuff, and having bought into some of them, and not wanting to forego. And Bob Dylan's a tragic, tragic case of somebody who was elevated without legitimacy, and it ruined his entire life. You might say, well, who would you say Bob Dylan's life was ruined? I mean, he's been living a lie for decades. That's ruined. If you want to know what God thinks of money, just look at the people he gave it to. So Dorothy Parker was a commie, but you know, it was a different time. Let's give her a pass. All right, so come back here. Now let's go to the next quote. I'm not a writer with a drinking problem. I'm a drinker with a writing problem. If you wear a short and a skirt, the party will come to you. Fantastic. Let's look at the next one. Pardon my dust was the epithet that she had for her own gravestone, which I think is great. In 1927, she was fined $5 for sauntering, which I think is, she got off pretty light. You know, if you're going to saunter, and the reason she was sauntering was because she was protesting a couple of anarchists being executed, okay? So, she was very involved in Spanish political movements back in the time of Franco and the communist uprising in Spain and stuff. When she died, she willed her estate to Martin Luther King Jr., who then gave it to the NAACP when he died. And Algonquin in art. So she was known as a member of the Algonquin Round Table, which was a self-congratulatory literary group that gathered in the Algonquin Motel and wrote for mostly New York publications. During the 20s and a little bit so further into the 30s, she was very active writing for Conde Nast, The New Yorker, Vanity Faire, things like that, where she wrote mostly short stories and poems, captions, etc. But she couldn't behave herself, and she'd get fired for writing cutting things about people who were powerful. She's a bitter, bitter woman. And of course, she never quit drinking. But the great thing is this. Even though she had a shitty life, by the time you swear you're his, shivering and sighing, and he vows his passion is infinite and undying, lady, make a note of this. One of you is lying. I'd like to have a martini, two at the very most. After three, I'm under the table. After four, I'm under my host. Fantastic. You know? Fantastic. So, one more thing I want to show you before I finish up with Dorothy Parker, who's, well, let me read this one. When I was young and bold and strong, the right was right and wrong was wrong. With plume on high and flag unfurled, I rode away to right the world. But now I'm old and good and bad are woven in a crazy plaid. I have to wait for it to come around again, I guess. Are woven in a crazy plaid. And meh, 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 meh. But look, I mean, one thing to note is her sense of meter is absolutely impeccable. And that's the thing that people aren't usually able to accomplish when they're writing. Whether you like poetry, short stories, whatever, it doesn't matter. Meter, just like in music, rhythm is everything. It's, you know, melody is critically important, but rhythm is everything. So it's like, same thing with verse, with writing. I'd rather have a bottle in front of me than a frontal lobotomy. It doesn't work just because it's cool and clever and quippy or whatever. It works because of the rhythm of it. When I challenged, put up this question about, you know, helping, inviting people to make Parker inversions of their own, people discover just how challenging that can be. As I've discovered, these things are hard to come up with. I've come up with like four of them. And I'm really good at coming up with shit like this. So, and of course, she was known as a compulsive editor. She said for every few words that she ended up keeping, she wrote many more that she got rid of. Definitely an NE user. But you can see that the reason she's brilliant is because she legitimizes on NI. Or woman in crazy plaid, I sit and say the world is so, and wise is she who lets it go. Later in her life, she started writing sort of poems alluding to how it would be better off if she offed herself. Pretty dark, you know? But she was ultimately deeply disillusioned with the thing that she was known for and a part of, this self-congratulatory Algonquin group, which represented all the F. Scott Fitzgerald pizzazz of the 20s, and then had to reinvent itself, understand itself differently in the 30s, right, with the Great Depression. I mean, the too-cool-for-school, cynical, quippy self of Dorothy Parker was perfectly suited for the 20s and perfectly ill-suited for the 30s and 40s. After all, you go from a period of time in the 20s where nothing matters, we can be nihilistic, we don't have to be committed to any sort of principles or ideals or anything, because there's not really any challenge to us just living and being happy and stuff. And in fact, the free-flowing money and free-flowing booze and prohibition-era sense of wild and crazy times, because everything's more fun when it's illegal. That gave way to a terrible hangover of the Great Depression, and then the need for genuine commitment to principles of World War II. Now, you'll note she was a very principled woman, but she went harder left at a time when it was almost offensive to do so. As you go into the beginning of World War II, you've got three clear camps, and they're very distinct. You've got fascism, which is essentially crony capitalism run amok. You've got communism, which is basically stupidity run amok. And you've got imperialism, which is to say, an emperor-style stuff, right? Empires, like Japan, okay? And then you had the Allies. You got your fascists, your commies, your emperors, and then you got the U.S. and England and stuff. And what do those represent? The right way. If during this period of time, you're saying, hey, it's the commies who have a right, or the fascists, or the emperors, you've made a terrible wrong turn somewhere, ontologically. So, in that regard, she couldn't ever get out from under her own cynicism, even when the world begged, by all understanding of reality, to abandon cynicism and throw the weight of your ontology behind a principled cause. She did so. She directed it towards the wrong cause, you know? It's like, so, she knew this at some point, and towards the end of her life, she kept talking about how, basically, referencing how she wanted to end her life, and I think, sort of, to redeem herself a bit, she latched on to civil rights as a legitimate movement that she could actually get behind that didn't deviate from her team thing, because she was guilty of that, you know? And yet sort of allowed her to be principled, which she had never been able to do before because of a whole confluence of various things. So let me read this one last thing before I call it an episode. I want to read this amazing poem, this great, sad, beautiful poem. So I'm just going to pull up this window real quick. Thank you for your patience. And it's going to look like that. There we go. All right. So this is a Dorothy Parker poem. And what I want you to particularly note is the beauty and challenge of meter. There's a very good reason why Dr. Seuss is so much more popular and so much more successful and so much better than most children's stuff. Because very few people can do meter correctly and well. And Dr. Seuss understood that the absolute engine and soul of his writing was meter, rhythm. Now, having talked about Dr. Seuss, listen to this poem. which predates Dr. Seuss for sure. I do not like my state of mind. I'm bitter, querulous, unkind. I hate my legs. I hate my hands. I do not yearn for lovely hands. I dread the dawn's recurrent light. I hate to go to bed at night. I snoot at simple, earnest folk. I cannot take the gentlest joke. I find no peace in paint or type. My world is but a lot of tripe. I'm disillusioned, empty-breasted. For what I think, I'd be arrested. I'm not sick. I am not well. My quondam dreams are shot to hell. My soul is crushed, my spirit sore, I do not like me any more. I cavil, quarrel, grumble, grouse, I ponder on the narrow house, I shudder at the thought of men, I'm due to fall in love again. So good. Oh my God. I mean, I know I'm in a minority of people who are impacted by poetry like that, but all fucking praises due. Oh my God. I'd hate to have to suffer as much as you have to suffer to write this poem. But, wow. Absolutely stunningly brilliant. So, you know, here are my departing words to Dorothy Parker, who hopefully is up in heaven, you know, being showered with unconditional love by exactly whom she wants. And these are my final words to you. This should be the epitaph I would put on your gravestone. You go, girl. And that's part one of maybe just one, but of history's greatest loadies, Dorothy Parker, American writer, dead 1965.